So we'll go into, well, first of all, I'd like our three presenters, Charah Watson, Dr. Fitz-Henley, as well as Nurse Wade, to join me on the podium, please. I was trying to wait for the room to fill up a little bit, but yesterday we ran super late, so I decided it's probably better we start now than... Okay, so our first presentation will be natural products and nutraceuticals in diabetes skincare, which will be presented to us by Charah T. Watson. She's the manager in product research and in the product research and development division of Scientific Research Council, technical director of Biotech R&D Institute and Medicanja Limited. She also has a Doctor of Philosophy in Chemistry from the University of the West Indies, Bachelor of Sciences in Chemistry and Food Chemistry, and her specialization is in product development and natural products chemistry. Her personal objectives, she continues to grow in knowledge and expertise and to make a significant contribution to the scientific knowledge, particularly in medicinal chemistry and Jamaican medicinal plants, and to add value wherever she ventures. Charah T. Watson is a respected scientist who have established herself and demonstrated command in the fields of analytical, organic chemistry, natural products chemistry, and product development. Her experience and wealth of knowledge has contributed immensely to the development of the natural nutraceutical industry. Dr. Watson has always been a part of impactful research, as is evident from the numerous accolades she received from her doctoral research endeavors. For the academic year 2010 to 2011, she received the Principal's Award for the Most Outstanding Research Activity for the Pure and Applied Sciences and the Dean of Pure and Applied Sciences Award for Outstanding Research Activity. The team later received a U.S. patent for the work in 2015. Her ingenuity, creativity, work ethics, and commitment to quality makes her stand out amongst her peers. Dr. Watson continues to innovate and contribute to the strategic growth and development of Jamaica through her role as manager of the Product Research and Development Division at the SRC. Dr. Watson is a cyclist with the Fun and Thrills Adventure Club. She also loves traveling around the island and to foreign lands, hiking and fishing, and is also a proud Rotarian of the Rotary Club of Ligonie Plains. Without further ado, I welcome Dr. Charah Watson to the podium.
Good morning, all. I think you got that extensive profile because we're waiting for the room to fill up, so I hope you enjoyed it. All right, how have we been? How was the morning so far? We made it to the breakfast this morning, the 7:30 breakfast, and I hope those interactions were good. So as stated by Donna, thanks again for that wonderful introduction. Sometimes you forget about yourself, you know, but it's nice to be reminded. This session, we're going to be looking at how we manage diabetes, especially conditions, skin issues that arise due to diabetes. And my role this morning is very easy and very simple, especially because I'm excited to hear what my co-presenters will be coming with. So I promise to be very, very succinct because I can't wait to get to their presentations. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about natural products and nutraceuticals in managing diabetic skin conditions. And when we talk about natural products, we are talking about things that are derived from mainly plant-based products, whether it be extract concoctions or just using the plants in their unadulterated state. And when we talk about nutraceuticals, we are talking about, they're still natural products, but those that you ingest. So without further ado, we'll go on. So if you've been coming to UDOP for the past 24 years, and specifically if you've been here since Thursday, you realize that diabetes is not power alone. Anywhere him go, him have him crew coming with him, right? Matter of fact, I like to call him a gangster. Because anywhere him go, him posse's there, and them coming with trouble. We've been hearing about some of the typical members in his group, but today we're going to be talking about his right hand, I like to say, which is chronic dehydration, who also have his cronies, which is your typical skin infections and skin issues that will occur. Now, common skin conditions that are associated with diabetes include your itchiness, dryness, fungal infection, bacterial infection, and numerous others, which I know Dr. Fitz-Henley will be going into. So I won't even try to go into talking about how these things present themselves, because I know he will give you a much better explanation than I can, because remember, I'm just a humble natural product chemist, right? So I will leave that for his presentation. But these are typical issues that you find that are associated with diabetes when it comes to common skin conditions that affect or diabetic patients. Now, one thing we learn, and we know this, prevention is always... And this is comforting in some way, because just like in society, if you prevent the root cause for crime and violence, chances are you won't have much issues, right? And it's the same thing with diabetes and the associated conditions. You've been hearing this since week. Once you control the underlying issues, which is your blood glucose level, manage your diabetes well, most of the other issues related will not be a problem, right? And it's the same with your skin conditions that normally present themselves. Once your blood glucose levels are properly monitored, chances are you won't have these conditions happening. However, if it's not properly regulated, all hell will break loose. One thing to note though, most of the issues affecting diabetics and their skin issues can easily be prevented, and most times prevention is much easier than treating or curing the issues that when they do present. So some general recommendations as it relates to managing and preventing these incidents from happening is to keep the skin well hydrated and moisturized, because remember, chronic dryness, and once that happens and you have breakage in the skin, then you know what will happen, because we know there's an issue with wound healing and those other things that will become a major problem. You want to also limit how often or how long you're in the bath. Also, the temperature of the bath is very important to monitor. You also want to ensure that, especially when humidity is low, you want to ensure that you really try to keep your skin well moisturized, and you want to use very mild detergents or soaps to cleanse the skin, all right? And always apply a moisturizer in the form of a cream or a butter to the skin to keep locking that hydration and keep the skin hydrated. Now, I could really end my presentation here, but we started in good time, so I will continue nonetheless and speak more specifically to specific natural products that can be used or have shown a lot of promise in as it relates to managing diabetes as well as skin conditions in general. Now, why do we want to talk about this? Now, I want to commend Prof. Morrison. I know at least since 2010, if not earlier, but I started coming to UDOP in 2010, and every year they make a deliberate, they're very deliberate in ensuring that there's either a scientific session speaking about natural products and its place in managing diabetes, or at least 1 to 2 talks. And why is this important? Now, despite what you want, your best advice, and knowing otherwise, most of your patients, them, I use bush medicine, right? So we can't ignore this fact. So we have, like Dr. Abby said last night, you want to know, understand your patients, understand the psychology of them, and meet them somewhere. You can't just tell them, leave that alone, because it's going to cause these issues. We know that issues will happen, because we all know about drug-herb interaction and adverse effect that these can cause. But guess what? I don't know if it's that it's ingrained in our DNA because our ancestors were always using these herbal preparation, but it's beyond just cultural, because it's not just a matter of being in a particular social economic group that you find persons using it. The data suggests that every one of us, well, 95% in the last KPE that was done in 2015 here in Jamaica, 95% of persons surveyed utilizes natural products as a therapeutic agent. So that is beyond just saying you can't afford the medicine. It is ingrained in our DNA to rely on natural products. So what do we need to do? We need to ensure that we know what our patients are doing and act accordingly and advise them accordingly in terms of how to manage their various conditions that they're using, both the pharmaceutical that they're prescribing as well as the herbal concoctions that they're making up themselves. Now, why again it's important for us to speak about natural products in medium like this is out of the KPA that was done, which is knowledge, practices, and attitudes survey that was done, you find that only a mere 33% of those patients, of your patients, out of the 95 that is used in herbal preparation, will actually tell their doctors that, hey, I'm using this herb as well, and I'm using this tea, I'm using this rub, I'm using this particular makeup. And this have serious issues. This is a serious concern. Why again? We know about drug-herb interaction. And we might know of stories very close to us as persons who end up in severe issues because they are mixing the two without under any kind of supervision. So it's important for us to understand what is happening and therefore plan accordingly. Out of those 33% of persons who actually brave enough to say, doc, you know, so me, I use little ganja tea for help manage because, you know, say, me not really like how I feel when I take such and such. Or, you know, say, this upset my stomach and therefore me drink a little bit of Circe or a little bit of ginger tea for calm up down my stomach after I take this pill. Only 56% of the doctors approve of their patient actually using. Remember, out of the 33% that know of it, only 56% of those 33 actually say, it's all right, you can use that. The other 45 is like, no, don't touch it. Do not use any herbs. Now, this slide is the main point I want to come out from my conversation with you this morning. If we know that majority of our patients are using the herbal preparation despite our best medical advice, and if we do not know what they're using, how they're using it, how can we help them in their best interests? We can't. So I want, the aim of my talk this morning is to really engage you, the medical professionals, to also engage the scientific community, and let's see how we can work beyond this. Because a majority of conversation gets stuck here. They shouldn't use it. There's not enough data. It's not scientifically validated. So therefore, let's not recommend. We need to move the conversation from there and now start actioning and seeing how we can help to validate and have more information so that we can best advise those who we are serving and help them to get better adherence to the regimes that we're prescribing, as well as helping them to understand the issues related to them deviating or including other things outside of the space where they can be supervised by the medical professionals. Understand? Agreed? All right. So now we can move on to, again, could I stop right here again, you know, but I'll continue a little longer. So let's talk about some of the commonly used herbs. Now, in every single culture across the world, there is a practice to use herbal remedies. Now, there are numerous herbal remedies that are used for diabetes. many. We can't, the list is long and extensive, but that's not my aim here today. We're just gonna talk about three, and the three that we're gonna be talking about, they're using almost every single cultural practice of folklore medicine right across. Everywhere you find them using these three. And at this point, I want to give away something. So I'm gonna ask the first person who can identify these three plants that are pictured. Prof. Morrison, you're not playing. Dr. Riley, you're not playing. So anybody who can correctly identify these three plants, come to the mic quickly. In the order in which they appear, you will get something. All three of them, in the order in which they appear, you'll get something. You'll get, so I guarantee you get something at the end of the session.
Aloe vera.
Yes.
Yes.
Cersei. Correct. So she's right. So we have our dear friend, aloe vera. We have neem. Those are actually the berries from neem, or the seeds which you extract the oils from. And we have Cersei, more commonly known throughout the rest of the world as bitter melon or bitter gourd, but we call it Cersei, right? Now, we're going to be focusing on these three. Main reason, there have been a lot of scientific validation for these particular three herbs. And again, they are very common in most cultures in terms of their use for both diabetes management and managing skin-related issues, whether it's related to diabetes or otherwise. If you get a burn, what's the first thing you think of using? And there's actually been clinical trials which show that aloe vera gives better impact than when using silver-related compounds in helping the wound to heal and reducing the incidence of scarring. So they have been validated scientifically to an extent, and you find, have to go preparing for this presentation, finding multiple clinical reviews, and at the end of the day, they're still saying inconclusive because of other things that we'll get to as we continue our conversation. And that is where we want to ensure that at the end of today, I will definitely have Dr. Fitz-Henley's contact. We're definitely going to be following up with Donna as well as nurse here in terms of how we can actually structure programs to now evaluate and see what our patients are using and help to add to the scientific knowledge that can best inform how these things are used. That is the aim that we want to achieve. So we're going to start with looking at aloe vera. Now, aloe vera has very common use in terms of managing diabetes itself, in terms of its impact on lowering blood glucose level. There have been numerous clinical studies that shows or demonstrate how extracts or isolates from aloe vera is able to do this. And they actually found that it have the ability to decrease the fasting blood glucose levels, as well as decrease the A1C. In terms of the active components, these have been isolated. One of the main active components found from aloe vera is a carbohydrate or a polysaccharide that is actually shown in clinical studies to have significant impact in managing diabetes. As I stated earlier, one of the issues is, however, is how do we prepare this compound? So isolation was done, and then you went in and do whether in vitro studies. Some clinical trials with actual human subjects, but those preparations were done in a particular way. Now, when your patients are using it at home, they're not using it the same way that those things were prepared when these trials were being conducted. And you also find within the trials that are being reported, the preparations differ significantly. The dosages differ significantly. And that is the main issue that physicians have with natural products. It tends to be extremely subjective, as well as how it is prepared from person to person, from culture to culture, varies significantly. And therefore, how do you confidently say, this will give you this impact, and this is how you ought to use this? Now, that is the major concern that we have. But nonetheless, there is significant data that supports the use of aloe vera for helping to regulate blood glucose levels. In terms of skincare, again, If you look on the market, I was overwhelmed in trying to find an image to use, and I literally just randomly just pick one and just copy and paste it, because there's so many aloe vera skin care, hair care, nail care, every kind of care products. It is extensively used for skin care activities. And what we found is that it has compounds in there that helps to increase collagen production, as well as helping to improve wound healing and skin repair. In one of the studies, it actually showed that if you consume aloe vera orally, as well as use it topically, you get greater impact. Now, this was a kind of new to me as well. So you're seeing significant improvement in both diabetes management as well as skin care management if you take the aloe vera both topically and orally. But again, the deviation in terms of the quantities, the preparation, all of those still led most of the conclusion to say further work need to be done. Then we want to look at neem. Now, neem is one of those plants that I might be aging myself, but I remember back in the day, if you have a race, neem and Circe in particular, if you have a horse or a dog that has mange, what you bathe them in? And then you get that nice glowing hair. Neem also is used heavily, mainly in India and South Asia for the management of diabetes. They actually describe it to be a cure-all miracle plant. What has been found is that there is substantial dose dependency in decrease in blood pressure from the alcoholic content. Also, there is the same alcoholic content showed anti-diabetic effect in streptomycin-treated rats, and it's postulated that it's due to a particular terpenoid in the plant that has the impact to kind of mimic the how insulin acts in the body. They found it to also be multiple targets that involve diabetes pathogenesis. Now, in skincare, again, neem leaves has many active agents that are found to have both anti-inflammatory as well as antioxidant, antibacterial, and antiviral properties. In one of the studies, there were several preparations of neem and aloe vera. They use them to make like bar soaps, which is one of the ways that you find a lot of neem products. You find a lot of neem bar soaps, a lot of neem lotions. So this particular study looked at preparing various lotions and bar soaps with varying concentration of neem, varying concentration of aloe vera, and then using those to see what impact will actually happen as it relates to antimicrobial activity. They were looking at antifungal as well as antibacterial. The main microbes of concern that was evaluated were E. coli, which is the bacteria, and Candida albicans, which is the main fungus that you find on a lot of causing a lot of issues in diabetic skin. And they found that they had significant activity, both the bar soap as well as the lotion. Now, this particular study was very interesting to me because, again, when we're at our bench doing the in vivo and the in vitro studies, we're using alcoholic extracts or some kind of extracts. We're not actually looking at products that that persons are using. And like I said, there are myriads of different products that are on the market, and these are what your clients or your customers or your patients are going to be using if they're not using their home remedies. Now, does the impact that we see in the lab translate when it gets on the shelf in a product? And this particular study was showing that it actually does, in specific concentrations, of course. Now, for the most part, when persons are preparing their herbal preparation, they take in the best case scenario, they might actually use a teaspoon to a cup of water, in the best case scenario. But in the most part, you just take up a little bit of this and throw it in a little bit of that, and you make it soak for a week or a day or a month. It depends on when you want it to use, and then you get something. But this study showed that depending on the concentration, you can either have no impact or significant impact. So again, we're getting to the need for us in our society, looking at the cultural practices and the use of these particular herbal preparations, to actually get to a space where we can have validated, standardized preparations, after, of course, engaging our clients to see what they're using and apply the scientific process to it to actually do the evaluation that we can confidently say, move from the 56, that's 44%, and I said, don't touch it any at all, to say, you know, if you use it this way, maybe you could try this. Because, you know, I have actual data to support that if you use it like this, you could have this positive impact. So I want to change the conversation from just saying no to actually having, you know, that kind of conversation to encourage and inform so that they feel more confident and we get more adherence as we would like to see. Now, Circe is very debatable as it relates to its use, because of course we know of the liver toxicity that can arise from this particular plant and its regular use. But nonetheless, again, we found significant amount of data validating its use in helping to normalize blood glucose levels. And we found several research papers and clinical studies which show that daily use of up to 200 milligrams of bitter melon, but again, it depends on when you reap, how you prepare it, actually lowers the blood glucose level. This study was comparing its impact to metformin, where they had comparable results to using 1,000 milligrams of metformin. This 2,000 milligrams of bitter melon extract had similar impact of a 1,000 milligram metformin. In another study, suggested that bitter melon improved glucose tolerance by suppressing the glucose levels after consumption of your meal. Now, as it relates to skincare, the activity of fresh juice or extracts of the unripe fruit has been shown that it's able to... Oh, sorry, we're still talking about diabetes effect. But as it relates to skin care, we found that it has significant traditional use in both Chinese medicine as well as Ayurvedic traditional Indian medicine. And its main activity is due to its antifungal and antibacterial components that is present in it. Now, in terms of wound healing, you find that bitter melon has a very high concentration of vitamin C, vitamin A, and vitamin K specifically that seem to help in the healing impact. And we know that's one of the major issues with diabetic skin conditions, that healing does not happen as it should. So this is where I want to close off, and introducing you to the Natural Products Unit at the Scientific Research Council. Now, the Scientific Research Council is the main institution or government institution that is responsible for exploring different research activities on behalf of the Jamaica population. We have a very extensive research program in natural products where we validate, in question mark, because it can always question that, validates, but more specifically evaluate the use of different herbal plants and preparations to manage different issues. Specifically, we have competence in terms of looking at anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, antimicrobial, cytotoxicity to some extent, toxicity, as well as anti-diabetic properties. Now, this profile in terms of the different areas that we currently look at can be expounded, and that is where we want to build our partnerships. And we're saying we have to be the change that we want to see in the world. And how are we going to change the perception of both the patients as well as the physician offering the care? We want to take that approach where we're actually exploring more and evaluating what it is that has happened in use as it relates to managing various conditions. So we want to now look at how we can partner to have, whether it be mono-institutional or multi-central, single-arm prospective observational studies, because we can appreciate for herbal preparations, the gold standard of the double-blind clinical trials might not happen. And the question is, do we need to go to that extent? That's again a space for to be debated. But where we can start and where we can get very valuable information is these case studies, getting the information from our patients in terms of what it is that they're doing, start documenting what they're doing, and then start planning very structured programs to evaluate. And then out of that, we want to be able to present information in a format that is not just scientific publication that is speaking to the known, but in format that is accessible and available to the general public, because that is who we are supposed to be serving. The publications are important because it helps to validate yourself as a scientific entity, but we need to be creating more information, user-friendly information for the general population who we're engaging these research activities for. So we hope that we'll have a lot more of these kind of engagement happening. We will increase both the knowledge base of not just the general public, but also the persons offering care to these persons, so that when they come in and say, "Doc, you know, say, may I take half a pill, I'm going to mix it with a little X, R, Z in the next morning, and I'm finding that this is really working, and I feel better, I'm not so lethargic, I don't get the stomach aches anymore." You can say, "Okay, so tell me how you prepare it, all right, and what do you do?" We can meet them that place, and then we can now engage our research partners and say, "All right, we have somewhat of a formulation that this patient is using, and based on the clinical data that I'm getting from the blood work that I'm doing, there's something happening, because I know some of you have had that experience. How do we now move it from just that observation to now apply the scientific process to it, to now get data and information that can actually add value to far more persons than that just that one person? It's not just a story or a single case that you have seen, but we can now move the information further and add value. And with this, you can contact us at the SRC to see how we can strengthen those partnerships. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Charah, for such an interesting presentation. Whether we like it or not, we live in the land of the herbs. We have the best soil, we produce the best herbs, all types of herbs. The first thing we were taught in pharmacology class, though, was that everything is a poison at a specific dose. Even things just like water and oxygen. And therefore, the onus is on us as physicians to partner with the scientists for us to really study these herbs and for us to decide what's the specific dose, what's the real use for it, because they're going to be using it whether we like it or not. And our patients come to us for the advice. So you have our partnership, Charah, at all times. Any questions? I could take one or two. No? Okay. All right, so we'll move quickly along to Dr. Michael Fitz-Henley's presentation on diabetes, obesity, and the skin. Dr. Fitz-Henley has been my mentor, one of my mentors from childhood. He was my dermatologist as an early teen. Then he trained me. Now I'm working with him, both private practice as well as at UWE Hospital. He graduated in dermatology in the UK with the Chesterfield Medal for the first in the class with distinction from the Institute of Dermatology, London, 1985. He was a part-time consultant dermatologist and associate lecturer for 26 years, and then full-time consultant and lecturer for the past 4 years at the University Hospital of the West Indies. He has been a consultant dermatologist at Dermatology Associates Limited, Jaifa Building, 72 Hope Road, Kingston 6, as well as Specialist Medical Center in Ocherias. He has memberships such as Fellow of the American Academy of Dermatology, where he's a member, International Society of Dermatology, Dermatology Association of Jamaica, Caribbean Dermatology Association, American Society for Dermatologic Surgery, American Contact Dermatitis Society, Council for Nail Disorders, Medical Association of Jamaica, and International Dermoscopy Society. He was a past president of the Dermatology Association of Jamaica and a past president and vice president and founding member of the Caribbean Dermatology Association. He has special interest in medical dermatology, especially complex cases, dermatologic surgery, example cancer, flaps, keloids, nails, etc., dermoscopy, sclerotherapy of veins in the legs, chemical peeling, contact dermatitis, and allergy testing. He's author of a few articles, delivered hundreds of lectures locally and internationally, 2000, 2006, and 2009, awarded the Professor H. Williams Award at Caribbean Dermatology Association. For research for most relevant to the Caribbean, including the topic of confluent and reticulate papillomatosis, which will be among the many topics mentioned in this conference. He is back with us by popular demand from last year's session, and we welcome him to the podium.
Good morning, everyone. I must honestly say it's actually a pleasure to be here at UDOP. I enjoy the meeting, I enjoy coming here. There's something nice about the vibe of this meeting, and congratulations to all the organizers. It is super great when you have somebody like your friend introducing you. They say such nice things. But the truth is that when you have so many memberships, all it means is that every January you are broke when you have just paid all these overseas US fees. I also hope that my head of department who is here hears all these things so that she knows I'm actually a little productive, so I don't get too many of these letters from the university for lack of performance and so on, but we'll speak. We have an appointment to speak on the matter. And we proceed. I enjoyed the previous talk. You opened the batting so well, I hope I won't let down the team this morning. I see we collaborated very well, because your talk about the skin will segue very nicely into this. So, and I look forward to the collaboration with skin and these agents, because we certainly have our patients using them a lot. So you did your homework like a very good detective, almost like a Sherlock Holmes. So well done, Dr. Watson. Okay. None of you are Sherlock Holmes fans, it's just too. It's, you know, Sherlock Holmes, Dr. Watson. Okay, diabetes. Hello, it's a little, hello. That tells how old you are or how young. Thanks again for this invitation to come back. I wondered if they invited me because they realized that to speak about obesity, because some of us were actually getting a little bit more obese as time went by, and therefore one needed to speak on these things. But doctors do get obese, and of whatever gender that they happen to be. So whether males or females or whatever type, this could happen. And so we ourselves have to set up an example into the public. What is our objective this morning? Well, the first objective is for me to set my timer so that I keep on schedule. The cutaneous features of diabetes mellitus. We're going to list it because we're going to go quickly. Cutaneous features of obesity. We're going to briefly mention CRP. And to the cardiologist who asks me, why is a dermatologist speaking about CRP? Cardiologist asking the dermatologist, because that stands for confluent and reticulate papillomatosis, not the CRP that he knows about. And we look at the link with acanthosis nigricans and the BMI. Lastly, we look at what happens when we combine diabetes, obesity, which could lead to more severe complications, which is the theme for this conference. The skin microvasculature is affected in diabetes, similar to elsewhere on the body. And what is very important is that one realizes that up to 31 to 70, one-third to two-thirds of patients with diabetes will have some amount of skin involvement. And so we should be very much aware of this scenario. So what are these skin items? And some were appropriately mentioned a while ago, so I will go through some more of them. I do not see the pointer moving, so I will. Diabetic dermopathy, which is said to be about 50%, and we'll mention a little bit more in a little while. And ichthyosis-like change, another almost 50%. Infections, which is the biggie, 20 to 50%. Diabetic foot ulcers, which will be coming up more afterwards, 15 to 25%. A scleroderma-like skin change, 10 to 50%. Then everybody knows acanthosis nigricans, and less know about necrobiosis lipoidica. Scleroderma diabeticorum of Buschke and Lowenstein is an item that we'll mention. Acquired perforating dermatoses, eruptive xanthomas, diabetic bully, and all the complications of treatment. Right now in hospital this week, we have a patient with complications from therapy plus skin lesions, and it's a mystery just trying to decipher what is what in this particular patient. So the internist I'm not on, hence why I'm here on call this week, but I know about the case, and the internist is asking the dermatologist, what is the diagnosis? Well, it's still a puzzle and a process in evolution. Also, we can have keratosis pilaris, which is also seen in obesity, and we'll show you pictures in a little while. This carotenoderma, yellow skin, which you can see on your left, obviously yellow hands, and this has something to do with impaired hepatic carotene conversion and perhaps collagen glycosylation. It is helped, of course, by better control of your diabetes. Rubiosis, which may have something to do with vasoconstrictor tone. Calciphylaxis, which can be life-threatening and very important for us to spot early when we get these kinds of lesions. Now, for those who make up their face for this, you should see what the inside of the coronary arteries look like with all of those bumps that we call plaques. Okay, so it is not so gross, just that we can see what we do in dermatology. I was responding to the look in the audience from this. And it can be associated with nephropathy. And so you're getting necrosis of the skin. Can you imagine when we get necrosis of the heart? It's not too different, you know? Then next we have granuloma annulari, which can be disseminated. Lichen planus, one group showed even a quarter of the patients had diabetes. Vitiligo, of course, we all know because of the autoimmune link. Erythromelalgia, redness with pain. Dry, scaly palms, and anhidrosis, sweating disorders. So if you want to, when we want to annoy people, we ask them, give me roughly 20 skin features of diabetes. And you do well, and you'll certainly get a distinction mark, I'm sure. Diabetic dermopathy, shin spots, often overlooked. How many of us have actually seen this? Don't put up your hands, don't embarrass, because even us dermatologists don't necessarily look hard for it, because patients don't complain about it. But these brown spots, which are present on the shin, can be an issue for them. It's more common in males, and it may be a marker for the vascular complications. So it may be good to look at them. Just pull up and look at the legs and start looking and see if you see that, because it's supposed to be there in 50%. Now, the ichthyosis changes, more commonly seen in type 1, is also said to be about 50% and vying for the top post as to who is number one. Also said to be associated with some amount of microangiopathy. Then, of course, the diabetic foot, which we all know has a combination with the neuropathy and the peripheral vascular disease. And you have this lifetime risk of 15 to 25% of getting this problem. Now, next is the scleroderma-like skin changes, where you get thickening and induration of the dorsal fingers, especially over the PIP joints, and where it can be elsewhere, 10 to 50% of diabetics, type 1, also associated with the retinopathy and nephropathy. And it can be related to disease duration that don't have other features of scleroderma, and that's how we can differentiate it. They may have this problem with the inability to totally straighten, extend the fingers, so they have this prayer sign that you can see on the bottom of your screen. It may be associated with Dupuytren's, contracture, and physiotherapy may help. Diabetes mellitus, acanthosis nigricans, all medical students know this. If they don't even know what is eczema, everybody knows for some reason acanthosis nigricans. Velvety thickening of the skin, and it's dark due to the thickness of the skin. It's not pigment. So don't go and get the bleaching creams for this. What you need is to decrease the amount of epidermis, something that takes it off, a keratolytic, a retinoid, urea creams, precipitated sulfur, something like this. And we know the various places. Hyperinsulinemia activates insulin growth factor 1, which can stimulate this, and very often associated with insulin resistance. May also have skin tags, as we see here, and we all know that the skin tags. In fact, some people mention that the skin tags may, excessive skin tags may be a marker for impaired carbohydrate metabolism. I know it's very common, see them on the sides of the neck, so don't start touching the neck. No, 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 not in the audience here, but if you see a lot, then you can think about checking your glucose, HbA1c, etc. Necrobiosis lipoidica on the shins, yellow-brown, painful atrophic patches, more common in women, may be also associated with microangiopathy. It is not extremely common, but if you see it, there's a high probability that diabetes is around. But generally, it's not the most common skin feature. Here is a condition called scleroderma, where you get this non-pitting edema on the upper back. It's more common in males, more common in those taking insulin. Thickened collagen bundles, lots of mucin, it's very hard. And sometimes practically the patients cannot move their shoulders, they have restrictions with breathing, and it doesn't respond very well to therapy. Do not confuse this with scleroderma, which is more an acral problem in terms of changes with the digits. So this is scleroderma and not scleroderma. The perforating disorders, not as it's uncommon, but not as rare as you might think. We saw one just about 2 weeks ago on the medical floor, somebody getting dialysis. So it can be seen especially in our renal patients, these thick keratin-topped papules, and it's often associated with trauma. The patients are scratching a lot, so the collagen and elastin comes out in the skin. It's like it's being pushed out to the surface, and you get these little bumps on the surface. So you might think it's mosquito bites or something else. Just think about this perforating disorder in diabetics, especially if they have renal problems. They have to stop scratching the skin to get better. Eruptive xanthomas. At the top, you can see that they may look a little yellow. At the bottom, a little more pink-brown. And it's triglycerides. So for those who like MCQs, this one is triglycerides rather than cholesterol levels. Diabetic blisters. Blisters on the feet can have many causations. But in a diabetic, one of the signs is that it's non-inflammatory. Just comes up and is not particularly red or angry. And it's mostly acral. If you look at the top picture now of bullous pemphigoid, what you see is that the skin is inflamed in the background if you look to the superior slide, and you'll see that it is actually quite inflamed, while the bottom picture shows the bully, which are not inflamed. It just runs a course, usually gets better, but sometimes it can be quite puzzling, and we have to go to biopsy, and then some people are afraid to biopsy the foot of a diabetic patient, but it can be done. Infection, this is a biggie, and we have to be aware of all, we all know this story, diabetes and infection. Here is an actual case. We see a patient, 70-year-old diabetic, presents with this rash under the arm. They don't even want to undress. They want to pull back the blouse and say, "Doc, see it here." They never do that when they go to a gynecologist, but they always do that when they come to the dermatologist. We just want to look at the spot. Yes, some of you are a little awake. But because dermatologists are always so thorough, we check generally. So we looked at the toes, and there they are. We looked at the fingers, and there they are. We looked at the groin, and there's a rash. What's the lesson? We must do full exam because diabetics with fungi have to be, we have to get rid of all of the fungus. Take no prisoners, no leftovers. If you leave back some, they shall return. Just like the politicians, you can't get rid of them. Every 5 years, they come back at you. So we need to treat all the areas. 20 to 50% of diabetics get cutaneous infections. The most common is fungus. The most common fungus will be candida. And nice little things, you see the arrow pointing to the satellite lesions hovering over the central raw eroded area in a flexure. It can happen in the paronychia, angular stomatitis, balanitis, vulvovaginitis. If you get the dermatophyte infection, that will be in the toe web. That's where we can have the biggie, because that can be a source of secondary infection. So you'll see that if you have neuropathy, you don't even know the problem is there. You have tinea pedis, you can get infection coming through that, and then you get the diabetic foot. So remember, it's a dermatologic problem that caused the big problem with the diabetic foot, which Nurse Wade is going to tell you a lot more about shortly. Dermatophyte infection occurs in at least 26% of diabetic patients. So one in every four diabetics coming through your door will have some dermatophyte infection. Diabetics should be fungus-free, and we may have to treat them orally as well as topically. This is a spectrum. I will put this up to remind you, because you see that picture on your left? It just has little subtle ring shapes where you can see the arrow. Means 1 in 10 people in the world have this. So at least 3 of you here, 2 of you here, and 3 of you here have this on your foot appropriately. Don't start looking down. Don't take off the socks in this room. But if you see these little rings, it doesn't mean you must go to the spa and get a pedicure, because chances are that's where you got it in the first place. And now you're going to spread it when you have put your foot into this little water and they wash it out nicely and come back. The pedicures have no autoclaves. And I promise you, it's a nice source of continuity of infection. And it can happen, of course. Many people go, and it's not as bad as that. But I promise you, they don't always realize that what they're rubbing off is tinea pedis. And it can be in the toe web. And then we don't want to see changes like this, because this is where it's going in the diabetic. So you thought that was bad? This is what we get when the diabetic foot is not fully treated. They come to us like this, and they're dripping from the waiting room to the office. There's dripping water trail. And of course, the odor in the room is something else. We have to be careful, because the next patient coming in thinks it's the doctor's foot. They did not know. So we all have to take out our ammunition to protect ourselves after the patient has left. So we are all armed in this way. But that's the problem with the diabetic foot. It is a serious problem. Bacterial infections, and I think I have to speed up at this point. Bacterial infections, gram-negative infections are 3 times more common in diabetics. Pseudomonas can be severe. The patient we have on the ward now, the sheet and the dressings are stained green, so we know the Pseudomonas is there. It's not surprising. Cellulitis is more common. You see that foot with the cellulitis. Where you think the bacteria came from? From the cracks made by the tinea pedis, where you see the arrow. So when you see recurrent cellulitis in a diabetic foot, don't forget to look in the toe webs. Clear that up, otherwise you'll keep wondering why the cellulitis is coming back. And sometimes you need to just separate the toes with those things that the pedicurists use so that the toe webs can air out wedges, so that you can dry it out and prevent recurrences. That's a nice little tip in management. And the other things we all know. And erythrasma, it's always nice, because if you take out your Wood's lamp and you see the coral pink fluorescence, then you know this is erythrasma. In the groin, of course, we may mix it up with the candida, or we may mix it up with the dermatophyte. But if you have a Wood's lamp, the same thing they use in the bank to know whether you have given illegal tender. You know, if you borrow that, you'll see whether you have illegal organisms in your groin as well. So to summarize, and then we go a little bit faster, the common things then, the ichthyosis, diabetic dermopathy, infections, scleroderma-like, diabetic ulcers. I kind of teased out from the literature to put this together for you. Males get more diabetic dermopathy and scleroderma. Females have more necrobiosis lipoidica and vitiligo. Those related to duration, ichthyosis, the scleroderma, like the scleroderma and the perforating disorders. Skin lesions reported more common in diabetes type 1. Ichthyosis, scleroderma-like, dry palms, scleroderma, vitiligo, necrobiosis lipoidica. It starts earlier in those. Skin lesions more common in type 2. We all know the infections, as mentioned. Skin lesions not related to poor control, the diabetic dermopathy, necrobiosis lipoidica, the scleroderma-like, the scleroderma. Skin lesions related to poor control, the infection, the carotene, eruptive xanthomas. Skin lesions associated with microangiopathy, diabetic foot, diabetic dermopathy, necrobiosis lipoidica, the ichthyosis, the scleroderma, and purpura due to the vascular check problems. Associated with neuropathy, diabetic foot, diabetic bully, anhidrosis, hyperhidrosis. Those related to glycosylation, the scleroderma-like and the carotenoderma. Skin lesions related to the nephropathy, scleroderma-like, diabetic dermopathy, perforating disorders, and the calciphylaxis. Skin lesions associated with retinopathy, scleroderma-like, diabetic dermopathy, ichthyosis, and diabetic bully, and miscellaneous, as we mentioned, the acanthosis, and so on. Now we come to the obesity. Interestingly, hyperhidrosis, sweating, plantar hyperkeratosis are two of the more commonly thought true associations, because your soles get thick because you have more pressure on it, which is natural. And we saw that up to yesterday in the clinic at the university. In that block, you'll see all the venous problems which are aggravated by obesity and a mixture of other things on the other side, which we'll just go through quickly. Insulin resistance, acanthosis nigricans, that's the most common manifestation. 74% of obese patients have this acanthosis nigricans associated with increased insulin levels. Elevated insulin, decreased functional insulin receptors, shift to binding with insulin growth factors, recipe for acanthosis nigricans. It's due to acanthosis, not pigmentation. So you get this velvety pigmentation of the neck. You get it in the axilla, you get it in the groin, sorry, no picture, naughty, naughty, elbows, and the knuckles, and on the face. That's it. Hyperinsulinemia also increases your ovarian androgens, and the patients very often come out looking hirsute, and they get acne. They may also have polycystic ovarian syndrome, and as you mentioned, they may get the skin tags, and which will come up on the side of the neck with the acanthosis nigricans. Now we have the keratosis pilaris. This is what it looks like, little bumps, especially seen on the outsides of the arms and thighs. You see it a lot in teenagers as they start to put on weight, but adults will also get it as the weight goes on. On the back, it's often mistaken as acne, so you're wondering why these little dark spots that you're treating for acne don't go away, because many times it's really keratosis pilaris. Look on the outside of your arm, outside of your thighs, and see if you see that. So atopic patients get it, patients who put on weight, patients with insulin resistance. Look out for that little thing. The hyperandrogenism and hirsutism, we mentioned a little bit of that, but just to emphasize that adipose tissue synthesizes testosterone, so it makes you more manly. Hyperinsulinemia increases production of ovarian androgens. So all of this is a recipe for all the consequential skin changes that we get. I'm still waiting for my wrap-up signal. Stretch marks. We know about stretch marks, but it can be red at first, and patients say, what are we to do with these red blood vessels? What is red stretch marks? And then it becomes pale, as we know. Then we know the consequences of having all these lymphatic and vascular problems, which will be aggravated by obesity, the stasis, as you see up the top, the lipodermatosclerosis, which you see to your right, and the venous ulceration to the bottom left. Cellulite is also made worse by this, but diet doesn't help, and we can't go into that right now. Skin infections, that's again the biggie. Look at this, same old yeast. Why? Because skin is normally acidic. When we have a high BMI, our skin goes to an alkaline mode. And the candida, the fungus, loves the alkaline environment. Hence, in obesity, we get the problem. It is an environment conducive, along with all the ripples on the tummy, with all these folds and the maceration, etc. And as you see in that one on the abdomen, then that's a recipe for the intertrigo and the candida. And here are the satellite lesions again. And here are the similar picture that you saw before, candida. And candida balanitis can be, I remember many decades ago, diagnosing a patient with diabetes mellitus who presented just with the balanitis. So it can be a presenting feature. Erythrasma, which you got to see as well. So there's overlap. Notice that. This is just from obesity. And look at this. Obesity is a risk factor for tinea pedis and onychomycosis. It can be a portal of entry for serious foot infection in a diabetic. And we already spoken about the diabetic. So we already see of that problem. Gout can be provoked. And this is tophaceous gout. So if you see papules on the ear, think about gout. And psoriasis is now firmly entrenched as part of the metabolic syndrome. Patients with psoriasis, for the cardiologist, are at higher risk for getting a heart attack, and for the neurologist, for getting strokes. And why is there this relationship? Because if you look at the cytokine profile and et cetera, psoriasis is a Th1-driven process. So too is the metabolic syndrome. And we don't have time to look, but the cytokines in red show that there's an overlap. So there's a similar underlying mechanism, and that's why they're associated. So now that the dermatologists are treating the skin with all of these TNF-alpha inhibitors and the biologics, we're finding better outcomes in the cardiovascular world. Of course, just means the dermatologists are leading the way and showing up the cardiologists. In summary, the skin conditions which are statistically associated with obesity are striae, plantar hyperkeratosis, the skin tags, intertrigo, pseudoacanthosis nigricans, keratosis pilaris, lymphedema, bacterial infections. I think I have 2 minutes and I'm going to go fast. So this is just to show you the CRP, just the introduction, confluent and reticulate papillomatosis, this rash that comes on your skin. And commonly seen in these patients, look at that, they have pityriasis. They think they have pityriasis versicolor. We saw one just yesterday in the clinic being treated for pityriasis versicolor. They're overweight, they have the acanthosis nigricans, and they have this condition called CRP. This is a patient I saw in 2002. She only had some eczema. She put on 40 pounds. She comes back later. She says she has this brown rash on the chest. When we look, there's a CRP right in the middle of the chest. What is this thing? The confluent and reticulate. It's confluent in the center, and it's reticulate at the margin. That's why it's called CRP. Here it is, confluent in the center, reticulate at the margin, CRP. Confluent in the center, reticulate at the margin. There's a little powdery deposit, and the lesion spread down into the axilla. And when we treat it with minocycline before and after, see what great results dermatologists can do. Imagine if we can do this to wrinkles as well. And then before and after, look at that, great results. Why is there a little leftover? Because on the left, was pityriasis versicolor. They had both conditions. When we treated the pityriasis versicolor, of course, the back cleared up. And this is before and after with minocycline as well. It's said to be rare, only 39 cases reported up to 1963. At the Mayo Clinic, they had the largest series in the world, 39 cases in 30 years. But when we looked in Jamaica in 2001, it was 11 to 12 most common diagnosis in a series by Drs. Dunwell and Rose. And it's not that rare. So to show again our head of department that we did do our little productive, here is a talk in 2008, 2010, 2012. Here are some actual papers that we actually did write on CRP. It's not that rare after all. And if, for those who want to catch up on their Dutch, you wish you can read it. Did this one overseas and it came out in Dutch. I think there's an English translation showing it's not that rare in Jamaica. So we looked to see what it was in Jamaica. And we looked to see what we got. And we found 42 patients in one calendar year. So this is their rare paper, rare thing. And we then had at that time the largest cohort in the world, showing that it's not that rare in Jamaica. Jamaica is first again. Some question, is CRP different than acanthosis nigricans? So we did another study, Professor, and to show, and we did it for about 11 months, and we found 19 patients in 11 months. 53% had acanthosis nigricans. 47% didn't have it, but I could be a little biased. I was a sole observer. I'm going to have some independent people look at it, and I think the percentage is going to be higher, but this is the minimum. 85% had an elevated BMI, 53% overweight, 32% obese. If you look at Prof. Wilk's study, which shows about 25% for each, and we compare it, we can see that we're well over. Finally, clashes. Thank you. She's clashing with me right now. Look at what happens when obesity, hirsutism, acanthosis nigricans, CRP. That's how it looks when it clashes. Now the big heavyweight clash. When you have diabetes and obesity,
let's get ready to rumble.
What you get? You get infection, that's leaky, and then you end up with this guy. And the ulcers, the stasis, warning bells must go out when you see that. It's coming. And when you see acanthosis, it can overlap. The anhidrosis, the hyperhidrosis, they can overlap. That's when they clash, and the eruptive xanthomas. So to avoid, try and avoid this complication, because this is the last thing you want to have happen when your patient drops to the canvas because of these complications. So in summary, we looked at diabetes and the skin. Sorry for going over time. Obesity and the skin, my watch stopped. Combine the morbidity of diabetes and obesity. And these are my references. And for those who need to check, this is the best one of all. I thank you very much.
Hello. I'm looking for a book.
What book?
Facebook.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fitz-Henley, for such a charismatic presentation. You see, guys, there's actually much more to skin than acne and eczema. Do we have any questions for Dr. Fitz-Henley?
It's not working. Is it working?
Yes.
What I'd like to ask you, what is the most effective treatment for onychomycosis? I think there's a failure rate that is, very discouraging. Oh, it did.
Yes, I heard. Thank you. Very good question. The number one thing to check is whether or not it is onychomycosis or it is not onychomycosis. To be or not to be is the question, because only half of bad-looking, craggy-looking, onychomycotic-looking nails is really due to fungus. So many times, people are on treatments for 1 and 2 years, and the diagnosis is incorrect. So I strongly urge them to come to your specialty and do cultures and get the microbiology right in the first place, so you have a foot on which to stand. Now, only 80%, you all are awake now, very good. Now, the best of treatments, 80% and so on, there's still some are due to the molds, etc., so some are not really treatable fully. The best for the commonest dermatophyte is still terbinafine. Then you can go to itraconazole and then fluconazole and do other measures of clipping and so on. And treat for long enough, but have that culture, because many patients come to us, they've been on treatment for 1 year and wondering why it's not getting better. Simple, wasn't fungus in the first place.
Awesome.
Yes. The question was, is there a scope for topical solutions? Definitely, especially if they have onycholysis, the nail is lifted, so there's a little cavity, you can put drops in there. If the nail is sitting flat, because remember you want to get the treatment onto the nail bed, then you'd put the lacquer, because the lacquer will go through the nail plate, get to the nail bed, but will not jump across the hollow. So if there's a hollow, put drops. If you have it's flat, put lacquer. And if it's very mild, then that's all that's needed. When the depth is more than a third, chances are you need something systemic.
Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Absolutely,
compliance, that's absolutely true. And I don't think it's a problem, but in the diabetics, we just have to push the message more. Yes. And it's absolutely.
Thank you for your talk. I wanted to ask about necrobiosis lipoidicum.
Yes.
The classical lesion in diabetes.
Yes.
When last have you seen a case?
Last year. But you should have asked me when before that did I see a case.
Right.
Maybe not 5 or 10 years. Yes.
Right. So it wasn't common before, and my clinical impression that it is also becoming less common. And I wondered if you had any thoughts about why that might be so. Is there any data? Is the prevalence decreasing? But it seems to be a rare entity nowadays.
Yes, it is a rare entity. Certainly did see it more commonly before. And sure, I don't know if Dr. Briam had any thoughts on that, but I agree with you. And we are seeing changes in other things similarly, and with that new thrust for research headed by those in charge of it in the Department of Medicine, etc. This is one of the things that we want to look at. Why are these things changing? Because it's not just this. There are other things we're seeing less of. I agree, but short, I don't have the answer, but it's certainly something to look at. I agree. And there may be a cultural, racial thing, because it's certainly more common abroad. So again, we're trying to look at what's the prevalence of these things in a black population and in the Caribbean, because there are definite differences as in the CRP. Yeah.
Thank you for the excellent presentation, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
In terms of the therapeutic success for the dermatological fungal infections,
yes,
it's reasonable to say the literature that's reviewed up to last year, the azoles, like itraconazole, ketoconazole, fluconazole, etc., the therapeutic success at the best is 28% to 30%, compared to terbinafine, the strongest in the world today. The literature says therapeutic success is 60%. That's the best that they could go for. Can you please comment on that, sir?
Okay. You mentioned ketoconazole. There's a higher incidence of liver problems, so it's advised that we never use ketoconazole orally, because if you get a liver problem, you have no, medical legally, you're not on solid ground. Just to mention that. There are different debates on the figures, depends on whether you have mycological cure versus clinical cure. So the figures will vary 60, 70, 80%. So mycological cure means, of course, that the organism is not present on reculture, but clinical cure means that it looks pretty and the patient wants it to look nice and they can go to their cocktail party without putting on nail polish. So sometimes one has to look at the figures to decide to see whether it's clinical cure or mycological cure, and that accounts for some of the disparity. But I agree, I think generally in practice and in the literature, the figures are a little bit higher, but the terbinafine can get as high as 70% and 80%. So ITRA is behind it, and the others are also RANs.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. I wanted to ask Dr. Watson a question. With the topicals, with the aloe vera studies, are these studies standardized with the percentages? Because what we have, you know, in practice is that the patients come, of course, they're using aloe vera. Is it 10 grams per cc? Is it the whole bush? Is it, some have irritation, some have help, and some don't, and so the just your view on that standardization, to maybe that could be a way to help to solve for, so that we know what help us to analyze it, basically.
Yes. In that particular study, they were using aloe vera gel. But we came across other studies that either use aloe vera concentrated extract times 10, aloe vera powder, or different preparations. So that is one of the issues that we have, where depending on the study that you're looking at, the preparation that is done varies. So here, at least in Jamaica, majority of us use the gel. We cut the leaf, get out the gel, we can develop or research as it relates to what our population generally use it for, because we have access to the fresh aloe vera. If you're looking at a study, say, done in the U.S., most likely it'll be used in aloe vera powder or some kind of other extract that is procured. So there is some standardization that can happen and relatively easy to do in terms of standardizing the extract, so we can advise from that perspective. So, yeah, we can look at that in that way.
Thank you. Collaboration shall be done. Okay, so we'll now welcome Nurse Natoya Wade. She's going to be speaking to us about management of the diabetic foot ulcers in Jamaica. Nurse Wade is a lecturer at the University of the West Indies School of Nursing, general registered nurse. She's a certified wound specialist and is a diplomat of the American Board of Wound Management. She has a Master's of Science degree in Occupational and Environmental Society and Health from UWI. She has over 5 years of experience as a clinical research nurse and is an avid researcher with numerous publications and peer-reviewed journals. She's a clinical coordinator of Advanced Wound Care Center, an organization that is geared towards prevention and treatment of chronic and acute wounds in Jamaica. Her interest includes improving the management of diabetic wounds in Jamaica, prevention and management of pressure injuries, and prevention and management of venous ulcers. Without further ado, please come.
Good morning, everyone. I want to thank the organizers for UDOP for inviting me to speak to you today on the management of diabetic foot ulcers in Jamaica. All right, I usually like to begin my presentation by telling you who a certified wound specialist is. Now, this individual is a healthcare professional. It could be a physiotherapist, registered nurse, physician, or it could be other allied health professionals. And for the certified wound specialists, they're certified by the American Board of Wound Management. They are able to provide expert advice, assessment, and management of acute and chronic wounds. They are also proficient in the use of specialty dressings and the use of advanced wound modalities. All right, looking at the global prevalence of diabetes in adults, according to the World Health Organization in 2014, it was reported that 422 million persons had diabetes, and of that amount, 1.6 million deaths occurred. And the prevalence of diabetic foot ulcer was 6.3%. Now in Jamaica, in 2007 to 2008, Jamaica Health and Lifestyle Survey, it reported that the prevalence of diabetes was 7.9%, right? And I think that is very high for our population. A study was done at the university by researchers that looked at the prevalence of diabetic foot complications, and that study reported that 12% of that population that was studied had a diabetic foot complication, and 8.5% had amputations as a result of having diabetes. Now, what are the risk factors for having a diabetic foot ulcers? Now, there are various or numerous risk factors. Some are quite known to us. Some of the common ones are uncontrolled hyperglycemia, if you have diabetes over a long period of time, hypertension, high cholesterol, of course, smoking and obesity, as we had mentioned before, infections, and repetitive trauma. Now, the pathophysiology of diabetic foot also, there are many components that account for the development of diabetic foot also. And I'm not going to go into detail because I'm sure from the conference has started, we have gone into these causative factors. I'll just mention neuropathy, where you have the nerve fibers, the motor and the sensory nerve fibers are affected, and you also have your autonomic involvement. Repetitive trauma, and there's also vascular disease where there is micro or macrovascular involvement. Now, what do we currently practice in Jamaica as it relates to wound management? We tend to use the very basic wound management, to say the least. So we oftentimes use non-adherent gauze, or we use regular gauze, right? And we oftentimes use wet-to-dry dressings. Now, wet-to-dry dressings can be effective, and there are advantages of using wet-to-dry dressings, but we have to know when to use it and the type of wound that we're using it on. There's also the habitual use of topical antimicrobials on non-infected or non-colonized wounds. So as soon as you see a patient with wounds, the doctors, or well, let me not say doctors, but clinicians and nurses, they tend to put on antimicrobials. There is also the neglect of the causative factors. A lot of times, patients will present, and all that the clinician will do is to put on a dressing, and the underlying factors are not being addressed. So as it relates to diabetic foot also, we have to address the underlying factor. If these factors are not being addressed, then the wounds will not heal no matter what we do, right? There's also the management of wounds are also based on the practitioner's preference as opposed to scientific or evidence-based practices. Right, so it's what they actually see in their training, what they see their supervisors do, or what they actually see out in the clinical areas that these clinicians will do when they're seeing patients. The management should be geared towards, when you're treating diabetic foot ulcers, these persons that are treating these ulcers should be trained wound specialists, right? And there should be a multidisciplinary approach. So you should have your wound physicians, wound specialist physicians, your wound specialist nurses, your endocrinologists, surgeons, of course, are very important, your podiatrists, orthotists, nutritionists, and your family and patient is very important in the care in managing diabetic foot ulcers. Now, for decades, the management of wounds in general, is that we tend to use gauze for everything as mentioned before. So they will have a one-size-fits-all type of wound care management. Now, developed and some developing countries are moving away from this type of management. So they're using a holistic approach in the management. So I've mentioned before about the other specialists that are involved in the care. We need to obtain a thorough history from the patient, need to record any diabetes complications and treatments. We need to assess whether or not the patient has any difficulty walking, if there is pain in the extremity, if the patient is on any medication, so whether it's prescribed or over-the-counter medication, because you know some medications can actually impede wound healing, right? You need to assess the hemoglobin level, their past medical surgical history, nutrition status, and the current wound treatment. So what have they been using on the wound? And if there is any improvement since they have been using those treatment. We also want to look at the lower extremity and do a physical examination of the foot. So we want to do our screening for sensory neuropathy using our monofilament test. We want to assess for pain, if there's any musculoskeletal abnormalities, vascular status. If the patient has an absent pedal pulse, you know you want to actually refer this patient to a vascular surgeon. Right? If there is any skin or nail condition, you also want to assess that as well. Footwear is very important. You need to assess the footwear of the patient. So if the patient has any pressure points, if there is any friction, you want to assess the footwear of the patient and ensure that they're wearing a comfortable shoe with an open shoe toe box, so it's not squeezing at any point in time. Now, in doing your assessment as well, you also want to look at the classification risk. Right here you can see a classification risk where it grouped the risk in from 0 to 3, where 0, there is no loss of protective sensation and no peripheral artery disease. And for that, the treatment and recommendation would be for patient education and an annual follow-up. And for group 3, patient has a history of ulcer, you'd want to do your education just the same, consider vascular consultation, and this patient is to be followed up every 1 to 2 months. Now here's an assessment tool that is oftentimes used when we're assessing patients. We have the Wagner classification scale, which is quite common. Not sure how many of you actually use this in your day-to-day practice. And we also have the Texas, University of Texas classification of wound scale. I'm not going to go into those too much. Now, when we're assessing each wound, we want to look at the classification. So whether we choose to use the Wagner classification or the University of Texas diabetes wound classification, we can decide which one we want to use in our practice. We want to assess whether or not the wound is superficial, if there's partial or if it is a full thickness wound, if the wound bed is necrotic, is it sloughy, is it granulating, or is it epithelializing? We want to assess to see whether or not the wound is malodorous, is it dry, is it moist, and to see whether or not it is infected or colonized. Now in assessing the wound as well, we want to look at the wound bed preparation. All right, this is very important because there is an acronym called TIME, which is developed to help with managing the wound bed. So T represents tissue, so you want to look at the tissue to see whether or not the tissue is necrotic and there is slough. So if there is necrotic or slough, any non-viable tissue, you want to debride those tissue, right? So whether you use your conservative sharp debridement or you use your autolytic debridement, you can decide based on the type of tissue that you're seeing. We want to also control infection. Moisture, there has to be an appropriate moisture balance, so the wound cannot be too wet and it cannot be too dry. So there has to be a balance. There's also the assessment of the edge, the wound edge. So you want to look at the wound edge to see whether or not there is any maceration, if the wound edge is indurated, if there's hardening of the wound edge, you want to assess those as well. Now for the management of diabetic foot also, we want to look at early intervention. So that is the key. When our patients come to us, you want to ensure that you educate, you intervene early. So you also want to educate them. Although I have it at the bottom of the list, it goes hand in hand with early intervention. So you want to educate them about frequent foot inspection, whether or not their shoe is tight. You want to talk to them about their shoe wear, right? You want to talk to them about their glycemic control and ensure that they are actually following up and doing the correct thing. Now, for diabetic foot also, offloading is key. If you do not offload your diabetic patients, the wound will not heal, right? You can offload patients using an offloading shoe, or what is most commonly used is a total contact cast, right? One of the problems that we tend to find with offloading is that the patients are non-compliant. So if you put on an offloading shoe, the patients tend to take it off as soon as they reach home, right? So when you have a total contact cast, that forces the patient to actually wear it, right? And in no time, you'll notice that the wound would be improving once the patient is placed in a total contact cast. All right, the next thing we want to look at is wound management. So if there is infection, of course, you want to treat the infection. We want to create an optimal wound healing environment for these type of wounds. And when I say optimal wound healing environment, I'm referring to moisture in the wound bed. All right? I'm sure growing up, a lot of us would hear about leave the wound open for it to dry out, right? For air to dry it. But that is actually not the best thing for wounds. There's also the use of moisture retention dressings, and two examples of these are your hydrogel and your hydrocolloid dressings. And you also want to use, if you're using these type of these dressings over, say, a four-week period and the patient has not improved, then you want to move on to using adjuvant wound healing modalities. So this would be your ultrasonic wound debridement, ultraviolet radiation, or ultraviolet light, and your TENS that the physiotherapists actually use. So those can help with wound healing. We also want to focus on pain control, and as I had mentioned before, education is key in preventing. Now, how do we predict healing or non-healing? So there are various factors that we actually look at. And one of the positive prognosticator is that if you have a diabetic foot ulcer which is less than 2 centimeters, if the patient has had it for less than 2 months, or if it is less than 2 on the Wagner scale, then that's a good chance that that wound will heal in no time. And the negative prognostic factor would be if it is greater than 2 centimeters in size, if the patient has had it over a 2-month period, and if the Wagner scale is greater than 2. Now, I'm not saying that the wounds will not heal if they have a greater than 2-centimeter size. I'm just saying that it will take a longer time to heal. And another thing for us to assess is the size. So when a patient comes to us and we're seeing them for a 4-week period, and if that wound has not improved or decreased in size by at least 50%, then we know that that wound will take longer than 3 months to heal. So once it has decreased in size in 4 weeks after seeing that patient, then we can determine how long the wound will actually take to heal. All right, so these are just a few of the types of dressings that we actually use. And these are specialty dressings. I'm not going to go in detail, just going to make mention of a few of them. We have our alginates. How many of us have heard of alginates before? Alginates, right. Alginates are very good. They are actually derived from seaweed, and they actually are used on high exuding wounds. Right, and what the alginate does is that once it comes in contact with the wound fluid, it forms a gel, and that gel will keep the wound moist. We also have foam dressings, and foam dressings are used on moderate to highly absorbing wounds, exuding wounds, and they can be used as primary or secondary dressing. So it can actually come in contact with the wound bed, or you can use it as a secondary dressing over maybe an alginate. And there are different formulations of the foam dressings where you have antimicrobial foams, which are very good dressings. We also have our hydrocolloids. Now, hydrocolloids are more like an occlusive dressing. So they're conformable, so they can go on the elbow or in areas that regular dressings would pose a problem. and they actually keep the wound bed moist. So most of these dressings that you'll hear wound specialists talk about are dressings that actually keep the wound bed moist, because that's what we're encouraging. So these are some examples of foam dressings. So the blue one that you're seeing here, it's what we call our Hydrofera blue. It has methylene and gentian violet infused in it. Gentian violet, right? The one at the top that you're seeing is your regular foam dressing, so these can be used as secondary dressings. The Hydrofera blue, we tend to use it as primary dressings. And here is an example of the hydrocolloid, and that's what it looks like. So it actually looks like a gel, right? This particular dressing can actually be left on for 5 days. And your foam dressings can be left on for as long as 7 days, depending on the drainage. Now, honey is a very common dressing. Not sure how much of it is being used in Jamaica in the practices, but I tend to see honey as one of those gold dressing. It has a high sugar content and a low water activity. So what it does, it dehydrates microorganisms if they are present in the wound. It has a low acidic pH, and that acts as an antimicrobial for the wound. And it has been proven that, well, it has been used for decades or in ancient times to have healing properties, right? So even the local honey that we have here, we can actually use it in wounds. Here I have a case presentation. This is a 60-year-old female with a history of diabetes. She was burnt by hot oil in 2008, and she developed an ulcer, which healed. Now, in 2009, she stepped on a pebble, and then she had a wound. The wound progressed. She ended up amputating the second to the fifth toe, and she also had a skin graft. Now, in 2016, the wound recurred. When she presented at the office, she had a GMR of 32, right? So she was not properly controlled. Here is what the wound actually looked like at the time. If you look closely, you can see that the edge right here is actually a bit macerated. And what she was using at the time is that she was using Savlon. No, not Savlon, but povidone iodine. So she was using that, using a wet to dry format for a prolonged period of time, because that was what was recommended by her physician. So she was using that, and because of that wet to dry nature, it caused the wound edge to be macerated. Over here, you can see that the wound is somewhat hardened, so there's some amount of induration. Right here that you're looking at in the center is actually a bony fragment that after probing, it came out that same day at the office. And it actually went down to bone. She did a x-ray and she was cleared from having osteomyelitis. Now she was actually debrided once, and I placed her on total contact cast, so she had that on for a week. And after two more follow-up visits using honey, she was healed in no time, right? So within a period of, say, less than 5 weeks, 1 week of total contact cast, and she was sent back to her physician, her blood sugar level was controlled, and she was healed. And this patient had this wound for over 2 years. All right, so that was what it looked like in the end. And that little thing that you see right here is actually a form of honey dressing in a sheet format, and that was used. Those are some of my references. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nurse Wade, for such an excellent presentation. See, it underscores the importance of the holistic management of the patient. We need to involve the nurses, the wound specialist, the nutritionist. I can't help it though, as a dermatologist, when you spoke about the etiology, the dermatologist needs to also be involved, please. There are approximately, well, at least 40 causes of leg ulcers. So it's outside the scope of this presentation, but we can help with that also. Any questions for Nurse Wade? Sure.
It's actually different from the Una dressing. It's somewhat similar to regular cast that you'd use for a fracture. It's somewhat similar to that, but it comes with a lot of padding, and there are different layers on the inside to actually protect the foot. So it's actually different from the Una cast.
Nurse Wade, I wanted to ask you, for the general practitioner who sees a diabetic ulcer, maybe a small one, the old system of using, cleaning it with Savlon and then dressing, is that out? How do you clean the ulcer?
All right, so Savlon can be used if it is totally necrotic, right? Because Savlon can be toxic to granulating tissues, or if there are healthy tissues there in the wound bed, it can be toxic to those tissues. So
even if it's diluted?
You can actually use like maybe a quarter strength to clean it, but only if there is necrotic or any if there is non-viable tissue, then you can use it. But if the wound bed is healthy, then we totally discourage it. So the best thing to use is your normal saline. That's the safest thing.
Other question. Is there a role for using green, purple, grated to clean up a wound? Because I've used it and it really works. So.
Yes, green papaya, it has in papain, which is an enzyme, and this is a de-sloughing agent. So if there is necrotic tissue or slough in the wound, you can go ahead and use it. But when you're using it, ensure that you put it in a gauze, so you don't want it to come directly in contact with the wound bed itself. So you need to put it in a gauze, and you need to change that dressing daily.
What about things like sulfaceryl and those? Are those better than antibiotics?
Sulfaceryl.
Anybody knows that? There's another one whose name I can't remember. Anybody remember?
Is it
Sulfaceryl? Sulfaceryl.
That's an antibiotic. Right?
What? I'm not sure exactly what it is, but it works.
Okay, so I'm not so familiar with that, but I just heard that it helps to enhance granulation tissue. So if that's the main mechanism of it, then I'm sure it's okay to use it.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
All right, thank you very much to all the presenters for such an excellent session. We'll move quickly into the 14th session because we're actually running behind time.